And welcome back. I'm the RPG Chick. Back with some more Torment Tides of Numenera. I found it, guys. I couldn't find it last episode. Where it says how they, your status with these characters. It's here, this thing underneath the portrait. Calistige reveres the last cast-off. Now, of course, the last cast-off is missing that. It looks almost like you can move this. It has a plus. Isn't that weird? So, Tiber lacks the last cast-off, and so does Aretas. Calistus friggin' reveres me. My god. Well, she said she adores me. So she adores me and reveres me. So, now we can talk to... There she is. Adiris, right? To finally get her to use... we can use this Mirrorcaster. Hello again, my sister. I am ready to give you the Mirrorcaster. You need but ask. Now, just to remind... I've answered all of Adiris' questions, and she will finally allow me to use the Mirrorcaster and speak to Mazzof. She pointed out that changing the past means anything could change, so I should prepare myself and tell her when I'm ready. Hopefully this will be over soon. So, yeah, we're in Mela Vest. Mazzof is not among them, but maybe someone knows where he is. We did that. We did that. She probed our mind. Talk to Melmoth about the tides. Gave her opinion of the endless battle. Resolved the argument between Andronis and Rima. And Melmoth about the tides. So that's it. I forget exactly why we're supposed to find this Mazzof. Mazzof is information. Mazzof says may or may not be like on this planet or in this dimension at this time. Shouldn't even know, but we can talk to Mazzof in the mirror. This we're going to do at some later time. Into the infested fathom. And the lost shepherd. Yeah, this is... We need to find someone, a doctor, who can help Aretas. Hopefully it's someone we can find, you know, in a place we can get to and it's not too late kind of thing. So anyway, I'm ready to talk to Mazzof. Show me the Mirrorcaster. You have proven to me I can trust you. Only remember what you have learned in these tasks. Be gentle with Zerian. You are violating his mind. Be true to his path. Find what you need and return without causing him harm. You have a duty to preserve his life as he intended it, if at all possible. Be true to his path. She presses the box into your hands. Tidal energy swirls around it, drawing you in like a maelstrom. You focus on it, opening your innermost eye, and you are torn from your body. Yay! I love being torn from my body. So awesome. When you first open your eyes, there's only a ruddy glow and frightening shapes in shadows around you. The air is hot and stifling. That's pretty cool. It's like the skeleton of some huge snake. But we got things tied around in here. As your eyes adjust, you realize you're outside, but the sky is darkened by clouds of pitch. The ruddy glow comes from lava flows as they trundle down distant mountains into the volcanic fields all around you. Sharp towers pierce the sky, tapered like bones of a ribcage. Indeed, they look like bones in every way, as does the ground beneath you. You appear to be standing on the spine of an enormous beast. The bottom of its jaw can be seen far in the distance, half buried beneath a layer of cooled lava. Most of the bone towers look identical, but one shines from the inside with an odd blue light. The top of the glowing tower has been snapped off, and what looks like a transport hovers next to its peak. It's your transport. You were sent here to find something. Isn't... That's an option. to change this text into, like, italics instead. It looks like... installing or updating the game changed that? I'm not sure. Anyway, you were sent here to find something. Twisted bridges connect the spine to the volcanic fields around you. In one direction lie enormous formations of obsidian. Arches, spires, a wall. In the other direction, a narrow pass is carved into the mountain face. The field leading to the canyon is illuminated by hundreds of glowing lights. You know this body wasn't sent to find Mazzof, but Adira said he'd appear. Perhaps following through events will lead to him. Try to remember who you are and how you can find Mazzof. You are in the body of Zerian Daywalker, a jack who can speak with the dead. Indeed, now that you remember that, you can feel the dead all around you. You can hear them. It takes little effort to know the stories of those who died here. You may even be able to imbue some of your life force into their corpses. Zerian is wearing a black, form-fitting suit that keeps off the worst of the heat. He carries a whip and various necromantic ornaments. Zerian was on a task for someone called the Chimera. He was sent here to find some kind of sphere. Perhaps Zerian's mission will aid you on your own. Use your connection to the dead to learn more about the area of the spine. You are in a place called the Fields of Ossifagan, and many have lived and died here, though it seems a terrible place to live. Scavengers from Sega's cliffs have been through here in recent centuries, seeking treasures of the past. Before that, it was mutants fleeing revolution after bloody revolution in a place called Haref. Before that, refugees from a village called Shunha. Before that, the Ossifagans themselves. You see a glimmer of a powerful artifact. Hundreds of years ago, there was a battle here. Many died. Two people, a middle-aged woman and a teenage girl, fought over a copper sphere at the top of the glowing bone tower. Oh, not a bronze sphere? I mean, we have a bronze sphere, so there's also a copper sphere. Perhaps that copper sphere is what you were sent here to find. Let's use perception to explore the towers around the spine. I'm not gonna top it out completely. Success! You search through tower after tower. Some of the chambers you come to are filled with piles of dead relics and broken ciphers, but nothing of value. Finally, you come across something promising. You find a staff made of some prior world metal. It's cool to the touch, unusual given the extreme temperature of the air itself, and burn marks blacken one end. Very likely this was used as a weapon. It may work again, but probably only once. You take the staff with you. Cool. So you get like a wand, like a one-use wand kind of thing. Where do we want to go? Go to the obsidian formations. Ooh. Cool. Crossing the volcanic plains, you arrive at the obsidian formations. Massive structures of cooled, shining rock leap from the ground, curling into impossible shapes. An enormous black wall rings most of the formations, rising 100 meters out of the ground in places. The obsidian formations are dark, quiet, and desolate. A hot wind blows from magma flows further off, but here nothing flows and nothing lives. In a distance, you can see the spine and bone towers, and in the other direction, the plains stop at a sheer cliff face with a mountain pass carved in between. Explore this area. Oh my. You search for anything remotely interesting, but the place is barren. Oh, don't worry, it's getting interesting in a second. As you're about to leave, an orange glow reflects off the lights ahead. An enormous paw steps in your path, and the rest of the creature emerges. It, like a pillar of light with claws, 100 faces twist in its body, emerging, howling, then melting back into the curling fire. The creature is easily 3 meters wide and at least twice as tall. The word Jamorn bubbles to your mind. should I really be killing this thing? I mean, what if Zerian is not supposed to be killing these? Let's run back to the spine then, I guess. You run. The Gemorn roars behind you, but it doesn't seem interested in you in particular. After a while, its roars fall away into the distance. What if I go back to the obsidian formations? Seek out the Gemorn. In the distance, you can see the spine and bone towers, and in the other direction, the plane stopped at a sheer cliff face with a mountain pass carved in between. Use your connection to the dead to learn more about this location. The obsidian formations did not form naturally. Creatures made of pure light, called fire whites, formed these structures out of hot, flowing magma, then supercooled them into the shapes they're in now. The whites were trying to get at something, or someone. You see a pair of figures atop a small flying platform. One of them holds a copper sphere that glows with a golden light. The whites tried to trap them here with their wall, but they escaped and flew toward the mountain pass. Another event occurred here. The fire whites have killed many people over hundreds, even thousands of years. These deaths culminated into the creation of something called the Gemorn, a creature of pure rage. The Gemorn has since wandered these volcanic fields with an insatiable lust for revenge, mostly against the whites that created it. Okay. Let's return to the spine then. I don't want to seek this thing out and have to fight it. I mean, that's not our quest, right? Climb to the tower for transport. You are at the top of the broken bone tower. Jagged bone walls act as a kind of parapet. From here you can see the fields of Asafagan even better. The spine below you, the obsidian formations in one direction, and the glowing fields in front of the mountain pass in the other. Floating next to the tower is a hovering pod made of azure steel. A ramp leads from the parapet into the transport. Use your connection to the dead to learn more about the top of this bone tower. Little has happened here, but for one event that immediately becomes apparent, you see a middle-aged woman, you know her name is Amma, facing off against a young girl named Thea. Amma is hovering in the air, like the transport does now. She holds a copper sphere that glows with a golden light. Angry words are exchanged, and suddenly Thea leaps off the tower and tackles Amma. The two of them soar through the air toward the obsidian formations in the distance. Into the transport or go to the mountain pass. I'm thinking the transport is probably going to take us to our destination. Guessing. So I want to see what's in the mountain pass and then come back. I want to see everything that there is to see, basically. So let's go to the mountain pass. Ooh. The mountain pass is still some distance away. Are these the fire whites? But you're close enough to see that there is too much rubble at the bottom to make your way through. Spread at the front of the cliffs is a great volcanic plain. Across the entire expanse are hundreds and hundreds of creatures lit with a dim glow that has nothing to do with the magma. You know these creatures are called fire whites. Cool. At the moment, they seem to be ignoring you. Okay, so we can use the connection to the dead again. I can use my lore mystical and natural. Or explore the fields carefully. Let's study the whites' behavior with our lore. Success! You stay near them, watching for a long time. At first they seem to be just wandering about without rhyme or reason, but then you realize that the shifts you feel in the air temperature are not random nor natural. The whites themselves are causing them. Indeed, once you figure this out, you can see how they use the temperature of the air as a kind of communication between each other. Maybe you could use this information to slip past them. They communicate through temperature. That's interesting. That's really pretty cool. Use your connection to the dead to learn more about this location. You see a group of people in tattered clothing march through the pass and out of these fields. They are terrified, having lost too many of their number to the whites. You see two figures riding a small flying platform, almost like a shield. Suddenly the platform teeters and the figures fall. You can see the spot where the shield fell, and though the bodies are no longer there, you can feel their presence very strongly. And there, a short distance away, you can see where one of the figures dropped what looks like a copper sphere. Alright, I'm not going to attack them. Animate a corpse and have the corpse get the sphere for you. That's pretty cool. I do want to do that. Use your connection with the dead to speak to those that died here. Though there are no bodies on the surface, you can feel the dead beneath the rock, preserved by magma that has flowed over this spot over the centuries. One is a middle-aged woman named Ama. The other is a girl, but she is strangely silent. Even with your strange powers, there is nothing there to speak with. Peace, says Ama. Is it better? Better, yes. Better oblivion. Who are you? Ama? The disembodied voice sounds like it's calling Ama rather than naming herself. No, not Ama. Shelved. Cast away. Eaten and alive. And eaten again. Not Ama. Food for whites. What happened to you? Buried to death. Before that, lived. Before that, died. Before that, lived and died and lived and... So many cycles. So many deaths. The air shivers. Her tone drops dangerously low. Before that, someone else. Awoke and remembered. A fight. A girl. Erlimnion. Though you cannot see Ama, her presence moves through you, turns your head. You see in the fields, in the distance, what she is talking about. The Erlimnion. A sphere of burnished metal lying in the rock. And you know this is what you were sent here to find. Why can't I speak with the girl? Gone. Gone, but not gone. You shudder, but it's not you who is shuddering. She woke something. Vengeance, though no vengeance is in her. You feel Ama's presence looking off toward the obsidian formations. There's something glowing and moving over there. Oh, is it that creature again? Let her return to her peace. Ama becomes silent. You sense a wave of gratitude and annoyance, but mostly the former. Then nothing. Her presence is gone. You feel like no asking will bring her back. Explore the fields carefully. You search for a time, but there's very little out here in the fields. You do find some kind of large shield embedded in the molten rock nearby. You also feel, rather than see, the strong presence of death here. You try to search further, but a group of whites crowds in and threatens you. It's going to be difficult to get past them. Use your connection to the dead to animate a corpse and have the corpse get the sphere for you. Reaching into the earth, you find the body called Ama and summon her forth. With uncanny strength, she crawls out of the cooled rock. Though her skin is charred and rotting, a cast-off tattoo is clearly visible on her head. You command her to collect the sphere, but Ama's body only makes it a short way before the whites attack her. Their hands reach inside of her, consuming what little life force you imbued her with. As they do so, the air grows intensely cold. Try again. I don't want to attack them, but I'm afraid to get the shield and sphere because, of course, they're going to attack me just the same. Again, Ama's body crawls out from the cooled rock, and again the whites devour her life force. It looks like you'll need something more to get past the whites. Alright. I want to try that transport. As you approach the ship, a tingling crawls up your spine. You have a profound sense of a task unfinished, and that trouble awaits you. Or at least it awaits the person whose body you are in, if you leave now. Is this what Adiris meant when she said to be careful with Zerian's life? Yeah, okay, we're not going to board the ship just yet. You back away from the transport. The nagging worry disappears immediately, as though it were only a brief hallucination. Okay, back to the mountain pass. We gotta take care of this. Should I attack them? There's so many. Or should I just try to get the sphere? What if I try to get the shield instead? And then attack them? Get the shield. The whites don't bother you as you try to pry the shield from the ground, but after a few minutes of tugging and digging, you realize it's impossible. The rock has cooled and melted and cooled again several times around the device. It's not going anywhere. Okay. Attack the whites with the staff you found in the towers. You aim the charred end of the staff at one of the whites and press the button on the side. The air feels like it rips apart as a scalding beam of light strikes the white in the chest. The creature disappears in a flash of fire and heat. The air grows icy cold, broken by irregular streaks of intense heat. The other whites back away slightly, but they are clearly looking for a chance to strike again. Study them? The staff is like a one-use thing. Get the sphere. As you close into the sphere, the whites seem suddenly wary. You're afraid they'll stop you again, but you raise your staff and they back off. You pick up the sphere and put it into a bag at your side. Suddenly the whites seem to have gotten over their fear and they slide toward you, arms coming for your chest. Run to the spine. I'm running! The air grows colder as the whites close in. You bolt in the opposite direction. They stay on your tail all the way to the bridge and onto the spine itself. So you duck into the glowing tower heading toward the transport. As soon as you enter the tower, the air grows warm again. The whites will not enter the tower. After a while, they leave, returning to the fields they came from. Right, so I'm in here, so now I can enter the transport. You step aboard. It's loud. Cool. The transport does not appear to have been made with adult humans in mind. There's only room enough for you to lie down. And even then, you have to roll on your side and bend in your legs slightly. As soon as you have done so, the ramp recedes, and the doorway disappears. Your stomach lurches as the transport takes to the sky. At first, you try to peer out of the tiny portholes, but all you see is pitch black, presumably the volcano's black clouds. Well, maybe we're in outer space. Eventually, they are replaced by the black of a starry sky. You try to see the land below, but it's impossible in the cramped space. Hours pass. Finally, the transport slows, its humming ceases, and the door reappears. What the hell is this? You step out of the transport, stretching painfully. You are in a strange cavern. Artifacts are strewn everywhere, in various stages of repair or experimentation. One wall is covered by a network of displays, showing people and scenes that mean nothing to you. In the center of the room is an enormous cage made from steel tendrils that twist together at the top. The cage glows for a moment, and a figure walks out. He wears a thick cloak, but his face is most strange. It shifts and blurs, changing its features constantly. You get the impression you are seeing a person, but you can't define what that person looks like at all. His name comes to your mind immediately. The Chimera. Took you long enough. The Chimera's voice is metallic and artificial, shifting as often as the features of his face. His expressions slide and change, but all of them are frowning as he reaches forward and takes the sphere from you. With your unique gifts, I thought finding a dead relic would come easier. The Chimera sets the Erlimnion on a nearby table with a clunk. He immediately picks up a variety of scanning tools, one after the other, probing the Erlimnion and its secrets. He seems to have forgotten about you. You look around the cavern, but there are no entrances or exits. Nowhere this Mazzof could be except for the cage. Alright. Examine the cage to figure out how it works. You take two steps toward the cage, but the moment you reach your hand toward it, the chimera stops you with a bark. What do you think you're doing? Your mission is complete. I have no purpose for you out there. Ignore him. The chimera grabs your arm with a grip like steel. No. Persuasion. Where is Mazzof? I need to speak with him. Success, of course. Mazzof? The chimera's altering voice slips from baritone to falsetto in a rapid series of notes. A dozen different eyes narrow with suspicion. I'm not sure that Tinkerer could tell you anything useful, but I can think of no reason to deny you. The chimera turns and slides a hand along one of the metal tendrils. Although no discernible interface appears, he presses his finger against the metal twice, and the cage begins to glow. The chimera turns his attention back to the sphere, indicating you should enter the cage with a dismissive wave. Two of the metal tendrils become a kind of doorway. On the other side, Mazzof squats on some sandy alien shore. Stars twinkle in the sky behind him, but there are no stars you recognize. He picks up his head as though he heard something, then he turns around to face you. One of his eye sockets is artificial, alternately projecting a human eye, a snake's eye, and something even more alien in the time he looks you over. He looks like a shipwrecked survivor, bare-chested, ragged pants, ragged beard. If so, he's better fed than you'd expect. Zerian, he says, his human eye squinting in the light. What the hells do you want? He peers forward as though trying to see into the cavern. Nah, don't reveal myself. Not three. Where are you? He spreads his arms in mock welcome. I'm on a goddamn beach having the time of my life. Does it look like I am? He crosses his arms across his chest. What the hells did you want? You're not in the Chimera's hideout. Where is that place? He only glares in response. Are you really Mazzof? The one who talks to machines? His brow furrows, while his artificial eye socket cycles through about a dozen different eye patterns in 2 seconds. His tone drops to a dangerous low. Who are you? The resonance chamber has been smashed. I need to know how to fix it. He puts a hand to his chin, all anger and suspicion gone in the face of a puzzle. Well, it ain't that hard if you know the basics. The chamber's crystal, yeah? So it's grown, not built. So as long as the chamber's core is intact, it should know how to grow itself. You just need a catalyst to... He trails off and looks at you anew. Why do you want to know this? The resonance chamber's only good for... He gives you an angry look. Who sent you? Why are you after this? I'm trying to stop the sorrow from hunting us. Mazzof barks a short, bitter laugh. I don't doubt it would stop the sorrow, and a great many other things. I don't know how, but the changing god's trying to use you. If that chamber's fixed, nobody benefits from him. Nobody benefits but him. You can't trust a damn word that bastard says. What does the resonance chamber do? The resonance chamber is only good for one thing, he holds up a finger, and that's snuffing us out. The changing god plans to use it to merge all of us, every cast-off that still lives, back into his body. That's his plan for stopping the sorrow. He puts a grease-stained hand on your shoulder. Look, I don't know who you are, or what your part in this is, but you cannot let him activate that chamber. You need... He glances over your shoulder at something in the cavern, though when you turn, you see nothing there. the First is alive, he whispers, drawing your attention back to him, and she's got her own plans for the chamber. One that won't kill us all. Our sire has a new cast-off body that he plans to use as a catalyst for the chamber, but the First has a better plan, something that won't snuff out every last one of us. Look for her in the bloom, he says grimly. Just make sure you don't... Before I can finish, you feel a wrenching twist in the center of your body, like your heart is being wrung dry. Your vision tunnels black, and you feel as though your body were being sucked through a steel pipe. You are being pulled out of the mirror, but it's far more painful than it ever was before. Then Mazzof, the cave, and everything else disappears. What the hell happened?
I'm ready to learn something new.
I leveled up, and we're loading into somewhere. What's going on now? Where am I? Oh, we're in the Spectre? Quest complete. I'm by the Spectre. You plant your hand on the icy floor and push, staggering up to your feet. Every inch of your... I like the rolling... like asteroids? Rocks? Every inch of your body aches as though you've been crushed in a massive hand. The Spectre stands before you, impassive. It may be your imagination, but he seems more solid than before. Collect your thoughts. You concentrate, struggling to gather your thoughts, but they whirl through your head like hot sand. The Spectre sighs, seeming less solid now than he was a moment ago. We need to talk, he says. You barely hear him through the pain. But this is your mind, honed in your duel against malaise, sharpened to a glittering edge. You inhale. Clear the pain from your limbs and gather your thoughts to you. Focusing, you open your eyes. The Spectre, now slightly transparent, is speaking again. I have something I've been meaning to tell you. You see, I haven't been completely honest with you. I'm not a part of you. You're part of me. I created you. I'm the changing god. What? The Spectre's a changing god?